following the whole Russ Filenix drama, which I try to explain again, there's gonna be at least one person, probably multiple, that start an argument about how my explanation of things is wrong, and oh, it's not because of this reason, it's because of this reason. Go watch my early videos to know what happened there. Following all that, though, Hector Martin of the RCE Linux Project left the kernel, and so did Carol Herbst of the Nova Project from the same thread. Now, the Russ for Linux Project has decided to publish a policy around how contributors should interact and handle the upstream kernel, because there needs to be some explanation here of what Russ for Linux is trying to do and what it's not trying to do, and sort of who's responsible for different things when work is being done. It's less of a policy, in many ways more of an FAQ. There has been a fair amount of confusion about what the kernel policies around Rust are, who maintains what, and so on. This document tries to clarify some of these points with what, to the best of our knowledge, is the current status. Like most things in the kernel, these points are not hard rules and can change over time depending on the situation and what key maintainers and the kernel community discuss, and what subsystem you're dealing with, and all manner of different details. The kernel is less of a monolithic project and more of a bunch of sub-projects in a monolithic repo. Each of these sub-projects, they do have this, like, overarching kernel development, but each of these sub-projects can be run very differently. So, how is Rust introduced in a subsystem? Like for many things in the kernel, it is up to each subsystem how they want to deal with Rust. Some of them do not want to deal with Rust at all. They will do everything in their power to stop Rust being involved in their subsystem. The goal has always been to get maintainers involved progressively, because the effort does not scale otherwise. Therefore, different subsystems have taken different approaches so far. Some subsystems prefer to actively drive the Rust effort themselves, taking patches, fixing issues, etc. This may allow them the chance to learn Rust in the process. This is going to be the case for the subsystems that are very much in favor of Rust, where those people were involved in the original proposal. They were generally just liking Rust to begin with, doing Rust work outside the kernel. This is not going to be most of them, but there are certainly cases like this. Some subsystems prefer to get a new co-maintainer, sub-maintainer, reviewer, etc. to split the workload, letting them take care of the Rust side. Some may want to do in their existing maintainers entry, others may prefer a new entry dedicated to that. Some may want to use the same trees to land the patches, some may want PRs from the Rust sub-maintainer, and so on and so forth. These are the cases of the subsystems where they are open to doing Rust, but either they don't know Rust themselves and don't really want to learn it, or they want additional help to make this happen because maybe they're already too busy with their subsystem, maybe they're too busy with the subsystem and everything else they're doing outside the kernel, and just having more people involved makes that go a lot smoother, especially people who are very dedicated to making this happen. And some do not want to have Rust code for the time being. For some of them, that time being is now until they retire, but you know, this is fine and expected. This is what we saw in the recent situation that led to, a number of crash outs, some of them leading to people actually leaving the kernel. Do kernel maintainers support Rust in the kernel? Yes, there are key kernel maintainers that support Rust in the kernel. There are a number of quotes in this slideshow right here. Let's go to page 45. We have a bunch of quotes from various different kernel maintainers, kernel developers, kernel contributors, whatever term you want to use for the specific role they are doing, along with people, if we go further down, outside of, there is a lot of quotes here. There are quotes also here from people outside the kernel who are just general stakeholders who, you know, are companies involved in the kernel, who are developers that make use of Rust and things like that. And whilst there are obviously the loud people who do not want Rust in the kernel, it needs to be remembered that most people either support it or just don't care. Like, they don't hate it, they don't like it, it's just there. That's the way it is with most things, right? Anytime there is any sort of, like, controversial thing, there's a lot of people that are angry, there's a lot of people that are happy, but most people just exist. It's like, it is what it is. And remember, Linus made the final call, but that call wasn't made in a vacuum. Now, some of the stuff Linus has done with not doing anything after the fact, I do think there could be improvements there, but Linus did allow this into the kernel. At a bare minimum, Linus was okay with a second language in the kernel. Now, who maintains Rust code in the kernel? The usual kernel policy applies. That is, the person listed as the maintainer. So, if you have a new Rust person that comes in, they are the one that maintains the code. If you have the existing maintainer who wants to take on that role, they maintain the code. The Rust subsystem maintains certain core facilities as well as some APIs that do not have other maintainers. However, it does not maintain all the Rust code in the kernel. That would not scale. So there are these basically like Rust fundamentals, which is basically maintained by the Rust fundamental subsystem, which is effectively how that works. But when we're talking about, you know, GPU drivers and things like that, they're maintained by individual maintainers, like everything else in the kernel. Nevertheless, the team can be approached for help if needed. Indeed, the intention has always been to build a mixed team of people that can help the kernel to bootstrap Rust. Eventually, the Rust subsystem could also act as fallback maintainers for Rust Code 2, similarly to how AKPM serves as a last resort maintainer. So if someone disappears and there's no one there to look at the Rust code, then they can take on the code, but that's a last resort. That shouldn't be the go-to thing. Who is responsible if a sea change breaks a build with Rust enabled? The usual kernel policy applies. So by default, changes should not be introduced if they're known to break the build, including Rust. So by default, whoever Git blames says caused the problem. However, that would cause a lot of problems because then you'd have C developers who are like, I don't know the Rust code. How can I change anything if I don't know if it's going to break the Rust code? That's just, again, not something that really works initially. Maybe like 10, 15 years as things have settled down, as Rust maintainers are in the kernel, that makes more sense. But for adoption, something else needs to be done. A subsystem may allow to temporarily break the Rust code. The intention is to facilitate friendly adoption of Rust in a subsystem without introducing a burden to existing maintainers who may be working on urgent fixes for the seaside. The breakage should nevertheless be fixed as soon as possible, ideally before the breakage reaches Linus. So if there are going to be Rust regressions in your subsystems, that's fine. But by the time it makes its way to Linus, hopefully those regressions have been ironed out. We believe this approach is reasonable as long as the kernel does not have way too many subsystems doing that, because otherwise it would be very hard to build, e.g. Linux Next. So if there's like one or two or three, five that have an issue, sure, okay. But if every single one of them, now we have a problem. Should maintainers treat Rust code up to the same standards? Again, ideally, eventually, yes. However, when they are starting out, not necessarily. The intention is maintainers are not pressured to reject Rust. If they don't have Rust knowledge, well, how can they treat it to the same standards? Because they don't know Rust, it's going to take time to learn it, you know, all of this stuff. Even if they want to try it, just because they may feel they will not be able to provide timely fixes and so on the same way they do for C. Thus, depending on the subsystem, Rust may be seen as a new thing, and new things can break. In fact, ideally, it should be fun for maintainers to try Rust. Didn't you promise Rust wouldn't be extra work for maintainers? Literally any additional thing, unless it's just automated and you never have to think about it, anything added on, by definition, requires more work. Like, that's just a nonsense argument. Since the very beginning, we acknowledge the costs and risks a second language introduces. However, we believe the advantages of introducing Rust in the Linux kernel outweigh these costs. So, specifically what was said. Under a second language in the kernel, we know there are huge costs and risks in introducing a new main language in the kernel. We risk dividing efforts, and we increase the knowledge required to contribute to some parts of the kernel. Most importantly, any new language introduced means any module written in that language will be harder to replace later on if the support for the new language gets dropped. Nevertheless, we believe that even today, the advantage of using Rust outweighs the costs. This was posted in April 14th, 2021. Years have passed. Have you reevaluated the trade-offs mentioned in the original RFC? As the years have passed, the advantages mentioned in the RFC have become more evident, and part of the initial costs have already been paid. For instance, within the kernel, successful complex Rust drivers have been written and improvements to the C side were implemented. Outside the kernel, there is nowadays increased industry pressure to move to memory-safe languages than when we started years ago. Whether you think memory-safe languages are the important thing to be focusing on here, whether you should write better C code instead, there is a lot of both industry and government push to have software be written in a safer way. And the direction that is going is memory safe languages. Is that the correct way to do it? I think so. But whether you do or don't, this is a push that is also coming from outside the kernel. On the cost side, a lot of the required setup work within the kernel is in place. A lot of it isn't. That's why we still have a lot of problems. But a lot of it is in place. Most Rust language features we used were stabilized. This is a big one. Early on, they were relying on a lot of like nightly Rust builds, which you can't have nightly code in the kernel. Rust compiler features were implemented. Other projects improved their support for Rust as well. Our duplicated C/Rust drivers allowed. The usual kernel policy applies, so by default, no. However, subsystems may decide to allow it temporarily to get Rust bootstrapped. There is a number of drivers where it's basically just the exact same thing, but written in Rust. Does that ultimately belong in the upstream kernel? Should it just be a reference driver that people can write and like base things off of? There's some debate to be had there. Is Rust for Linux driven by the Rust community? I don't like this obsession with making everything like a community because you happen to use the same thing. But no, the people involved around Rust for Linux come from different backgrounds and organizations. Some are kernel maintainers, some are Rust experts, some are hobbyists, some are employees at large corporations. Some might consider themselves a part of the Rust community rather than someone who just uses the Rust language. In particular, it is not an effort driven by the Rust Project, nor the Rust Foundation. In fact, Rust for Linux was founded by a Linux kernel maintainer as a hobby, and now it's become a lot more serious than a hobby, and, you know, a lot more heated than a hobby. Are companies involved in Rust in the kernel? Companies are involved in every part of the kernel. So yeah, there are companies involved in Rust in the kernel. You don't touch a part of the kernel without some company having some developer paid to work on something even just tangentially related. It's the Linux kernel. It is a major, major project. It's something that everybody relies on. Yes. As you can see, this is basically just an FAQ, but I think it's a very important one to explain what Rust for Linux is trying to do, who is involved, what needs to be done to make sure things kind of go smoothly, and what expectation to have when Rust is being involved in a subsystem. Is it going to change anything? Is it going to fix any of the issues that have already happened? No, but hopefully going forward, with things being more clear what to expect from Rust, we don't have as many of these situations again. They're not going to stop, don't get me wrong. But they can be limited. But what do you think? How do you think Rust for Linux should be handled? Do you think it should be handled whatsoever? Or are you one of these people who think there should be no Rust in the kernel? I'd love to know. So if you liked the video, go like the video. If you really liked the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, Scribes, LiberaPay link in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and my hair is just doing whatever it wants today. I need to get a haircut. What is this?